Until right now. That's terrible. Good thing you were paying attention. It'll be a great exercise to go back and then try to do your own narration. Put words in. It'll be a study guide, right? Study aid for the midterm. I'm not doing it over again. You can't increase the intensity. And what I mean by that is you can't increase the amplitude, right? The signal strength, it's only so tall. We only get so much of a change or disruption in membrane potential. If you look back on the graded potential slide, the amplitude increased with the stimulus. The disturbance got greater or larger, more significant. For an action potential, the disturbance is the disturbance. It's all or nothing. But we can increase the intensity of the signal through summation. We can send action potentials more quickly, like alarm bells going off. If we fire a nerve rapidly, that's usually an indication of the need to do something quickly or the need to respond in a certain way and do it fast. And we see that here. This is illustrated by what we call a supra-threshold stimulus. And I don't know that I really like that idea. It means if the disturbance, the membrane potential is really positive, it's supra-threshold. It doesn't make the amplitude of the action potential any larger, but there's some residual disturbance so that after we restore the normal situation, the nerve fires again right away. And if we restore the normal situation, the nerve fires again right away. Rapid fire of that action potential. So I want to show you the animation of the action potential occurring and the movement of ions. These are, again, Matt's slides. And they do a really nice job, I think, of linking graded potential to the generation of an action potential. So we see some of the same figures we've already seen today. They're named differently. Well, it's not surprising. We're in a neuron. A graded potential in the dendrites of a neuron is a postsynaptic potential. A graded potential that makes the membrane potential more positive is a depolarizing potential, and it's excitatory. So here, we have some excitatory stimuli that depolarize the body of this nerve, or the dendrites specifically of this nerve, and then increase or make more positive the membrane potential. We know this is due to the activation of ligand-gated channels, in this case, acetylcholine-gated channels. Sodium rushes in, some calcium rushes in, makes the inside more positive. Importantly, it moves that minus 70 millivolts towards threshold. Threshold in this example is minus 55, which is what we always use for our threshold example. Makes it more positive. To contrast this scenario, this is nothing new. But if there's a graded potential that hyperpolarizes, it's called an inhibitory postsynaptic potential. This would have been due to glycine activating its ion channels, allowing chloride to move in. Membrane potential becomes more negative. It's more hyperpolarized. And the resting membrane potential is further away from threshold. Remember when we talked about reflexes and we had complementary inhibition? So you want to activate one muscle, you engage that muscle, and you do a knee extension, you activate the quads. But in order for the extension to work, you have to inactivate the flexors. You'd hyperpolarize the nerve going to the knee flexors. which inactivates it, prevents it from firing, and prevents that muscle from contracting. So in a neuron, this inhibitory postsynaptic potential is a hyperpolarizing graded potential, same thing. In practice, it's not always so clean. You don't always have positive or negative signals converging on one neuron. In practice, positive and negative will converge on one neuron in varying amounts. And normally, if it's just a transient small effect, if there are few small stimuli, the membrane potential here will become more positive as the excitatory, the EPSPs, activate the dendrites. And then it will become slightly more negative as IPSPs, or inhibitory potentials, activate the dendrites. But overall, there's not much happening. Potential goes up, potential goes down, and depends on the net sum of all of those signals coming into the dendrites, coming into that neuron. Well, what happens if we want to engage a muscle or send a signal or initiate an action potential? What if we have many large hyperpolarizing graded potentials, many EPSPs arriving at this neuron at once and quickly? And I got the description out of the way because the animations are quick. What if all of these EPSPs show up quickly? We get a summative effect. Summation occurs where membrane potential becomes more positive and reaches, in this case, threshold. We don't have the undulation back and forth. We have a gradual rise until, kaboom, threshold. This is where the action potential occurs. What does it mean for an action potential to occur? Importantly, the switch flipping is largely due to these voltage-gated channels. The reason that we have a threshold, the threshold value, is the value that these voltage-gated channels will respond to, or the point at which they will open. So these voltage-gated channels will activate at negative 55 millivolts. So let's say that we have membrane potential at rest, it's pretty stable, and then we have a large positive summation, an accumulation of EPSPs, excitatory postsynaptic potentials, that make the membrane potential more positive and they reach threshold. What happens next? Yes, you're right. Voltage-gated channels open. We have voltage-gated channels for sodium and potassium. And importantly, sodiums open quickly, potassiums are a bit delayed. And that's important because we want sequential movement of ions. We don't just want them to pass each other in the night. We want one to move first and then the other. And that allows membrane potential to spike like we saw on the last slide. So sodium channels open first. Boom, rushing in of sodium. Okay, well, sodium's a positive charge. Now there's more sodium in the cell. So the charge in the cell becomes more positive. That's why the spike occurs. Good. Sodium channels activate or open at a certain voltage and close at a certain voltage. They close when the membrane potential becomes positive, when the cell is depolarized. So as soon as all the sodium rushes in, positive charge in here, now they close. Luckily, though, we don't keep a positive charge in the cell for too long. Potassium channels are opening slowly. They're finally open, and we have an outflux of potassium with the concentration gradient, with the electrical gradient, And now we have a sharp drop in membrane potential. And notice, we don't just drop to our starting point, we drop a little bit further. Potassium channels stay open a little bit longer. That allows the cell to hyperpolarize. We don't want to stay hyperpolarized. There's an important reason why we do that. We want to restore normal potential, and our good friends, the sodium potassium ATPases, go to work. Sodium out, potassium in, by harvesting the energy from ATP to restore this imbalance that was caused by the depolarization of the cell. And as we do that, we return membrane potential back to a normal resting state. Lots to keep up with, but I really hope that this illustration helped you grab the concept. I think it's a really nice way to see the movement of the ions, the opening and closing of the channels. Matt has said that he will post them to Moodle as well, so you can review these in your own time. If there are no questions, we'll call class for today, and I'll see you back here on Thursday afternoon, all right? Or morning.